journalism teacher. Your light show the whole hell and running around. So good to be here with all of you. You know, it's my honor to introduce another passenger this morning.
You
still have,
I slept on your couch last night.
You also slept on my Airbnb. Talking about anti-bullying, talking about setting goals with the students. He's now working with Lieutenant Governor Shatsutsui with his REACH initiative to, you know, give kids more meaningful things to do in the after-school hours where the majority of crimes are committed by juveniles. You know, so he's here on island. Coming up in the next few months, he'll be doing alcohol and drug abuse prevention through the Department of Liquor Control of the county. You know, there's so much more to this gentleman than the entertainer that Hawai'i has known and loved for coming up on 3 decades. So without any further ado, Mr. Augusto Tuba.
And his couch was amazing. And everybody's like always hot. So the aircon is running 24/7, so my electric bill is like $600 a month. Sleeping out when I worked in the county was challenging.
That was the free couch I found on the homestead.
That's awesome. Well, you know, the last 24 hours has been back. Like Eli said, 26 years, and also all the challenges I've gone through. It's never easy to talk about some of the challenges. Staff, you know, I get me, and I really don't. You know, it's just that. 6 years, and you know, I always tell people, like, sometimes in the middle of my routine, I always ask people, how much time do you think I've had complaints? How many complaints I've had in the last 26 years? Filipinos never like that. And you know, and now when you watch him do his comedy, he's always telling the reason why he's doing comedy. Like, he gives you a whole biography of his life. You know, people want to be, you know, people want to be entertained, and they want to know, you know, what you come, you know, what you. When you come up with those ideas, you know, I'm getting everything out. And I think the reason why I'm a person, it has helped a lot of people. Like, I've talked about my sons. I have two openly gay sons. The gay community got mad. He's like, he's teasing. He's making fun of me. Attack. It's impressive people talking about something, you know.
But Frank's doing it with his mama.
Yeah, but you know, exactly. And you have to be as a person, and it's helped many people. He wanted to kill his son because he was gay. He wanted to beat his son up because he was gay. I'm like, wow. And he said, and I saw your mom so much. You realize what you're doing is really helping people sometimes, you know. And I've had amazing stories the last 26 years. So, you know, recapping the last 24 hours, like being openly and honest with the students, really, like, helped me grow as a person too, you know. I should have been a casualty of, you know, all the stats. You know, when I grew up in public, I was a blonde hair lady, about this tall. She's, you know, she's about 4'6", her opponent is like 4'7". Dad is full-blooded Filipino. My grandma and grandpa came from the Philippines in 1916 to work in a plantation. And that's the reason why I look Mexican. So, that blend. Extremely poor, guys, like public housing, you know. Nah. You ever, like, I don't know if you guys ever experienced this, but like, you ever swim the whole day and you're hungry and you're running home and you smell chicken? You go, oh, I hope that's coming from my house. Oh, I hope that's my house. And not your house. It was like that weekly at my house because we're poor. You know, we're like extremely poor. I am the oldest of my dad's second marriage. Everything he could possibly, he did. Robbery, some drugs, you know, and if you live that lifestyle. Brothers below me, one was a casualty of ICE 30 years ago. He took his life, shot himself when he was 18 years old, 2 weeks before graduation. So, you know, a lot of the challenges and trauma in my life really helped me shape this summer. And my auntie brought me to a concert, Yvonne Elliman. You know Yvonne Elliman? She did the song, "Can't Help You." Yeah, I was like, why am I here? And my dad's like, she's awesome, right? But the guy that was opening for Yvonne Element was Andy Bumatai. I was in the sixth grade, I was like, holy smoke, this guy's making 3,000 people laugh. And I was like, that's what I mean. And my auntie bought me all the cassette tapes, all the albums, you remember my albums? Just by listening to it. I mean, very, you know, repetitive. And I knew, like, wow, that's what I wanted to become. I wanted to become a stand-up comic. And I think I was labeled. I was definitely bullied. Come on, my mom was howling. My dad's Filipino and living in Cali. You got beat up, all of that. And I just remember flunking English in the eighth grade. You know, I talk about several people in my life that helped me. And a lot of them was educators, like yourself, teachers. You know, in the eighth grade, Ms. Murakami saw that I was flunking. She knew that I was chiming out a lot of things. But she also knew, like, I loved listening to comedy. And, you know, it was cool because I did good English and I did pidgin. You know, it helped. She's like, okay, this is how you do it. And she helped me for 3 weeks. You know, like, I really worked on it and I was prepared. And I went to school that day. You know, all the nerdy kids was behind the curtain looking at me like, what you doing here? You don't belong here. I was like, well, how's this guy judging me? I was like, let me punch your face now. But I never say that out loud. I was thinking that, right? I was like, yeah, that's okay. I will show you. Because I felt like all my life I had to show and prove, you know, not only to my parents, not only to my neighbors, but everybody, because I was always challenged. They're like, wow, okay, I got something to prove. And then the curtain opens, you guys. And then my friends in my neighborhood, you know, all my Samoan friends was in the back going, get off the stage! You don't belong on the stage! Only the spot kids still on stage, get off the stage! So the teacher took time out to, I did the speech contest that day, I did, you know, housekeeping, banana challenge.
This is Mr. Fogarty from 1225 while I go to some dinner and have a
sleep. And what would you like? Cheeseburger, deluxe french fries, and a thick chocolate malt. But cheeseburger, do you like tamarind deluxe with cheese on the top? Or cheeseburger deluxe?
Who lived in the public housing saw me with my trophy, and everybody wanted to walk with me home with my trophy. I'm like, hold on, no, it's mine.
It's easy. Just, there's people in my life that are helping me, and there's people that, you know, challenge me to the point where, like, I hate. And one of them was an educator. Sat down and told me that I shouldn't speak the way I speak, and if you don't change, you cannot be a part of my speech club. I'm like, whoa. And I know she was trying to get to the point where, like, you know, she just wanted to challenge me, and, you know, to, you know, that, you know, but like, I felt like it was just so brutal the way she did it. You know, like, I felt like she was typecasting me, like, I don't belong here. And I felt that. And that bothered me for years. To the point where, like, you know, I win my first Tahoku Hanohana Award on live TV. I go, this is for Mrs. Yi, Farrakhan High School speech coordinator, who said I wasn't going to be nothing. You know, and I wrote, if you go back and you read some of my articles, I miss you. But I didn't realize how much that affected me as a person. Like, even as an adult, I was so mad and angry. I felt like every time somebody was looking at me, they're judging. You know, it scarred me for life. And I just remember, like, at about 32 years old, I'm on vacation on the island of Lanai, and this Chinese man came up to me and said, my wife wants to have a word with you. And I went, oh, here's the complaints. And I went to see her, and it was Miss. So mad at this lady, and she started crying, and I knew that she was sorry. I was like, wow. And I just remember saying all those bad things. Going on TV, just, you know, outing her. And, you know, she said that. You know, she should have said that. I'm an angry man now. You know, and, you know, during that time, it was challenging because my brother took his life. You know, and it's like, man, things. You know, why are things the way things are? You know, why are people so judgmental? Why do we go through all these challenges? You know, and why even he did that? You know, and so sad because we have resources, like, so I give the perspective of a guy who don't understand. Like, how come you're gonna do things that way instead of this way? like, you know, a couple weeks ago, my son came in and said, "Dad, can you pay for my wedding reception?" And I'm like, "Why you gotta be the girl? Am I gonna pay everything?" Of course, it's a joke, but then, you know, it helps bring up stuff that, you know, people are thinking about, you know, and, you know, these last 3 years, going into schools, you know there's a lot of challenges that the kids are going through and stuff like that, but I honestly see kids, like, thrive, you know, I honestly see kids that just want the tools. My dad wasn't affectionate. I never had one dad that said, "Come here, boy." And I was like, whew. I was like, just, I would come home and sometimes I'm like, you know, like, when you had that moment where you're looking at your dad and your mom and you just like, "Oh, yeah, I just like that, you know, I love you." And not until he was like in his 80s when he had dementia. You know, like how some people, they really get really bad or they took the opposite. My dad became this loving guy that I don't even know. Like, "Are you sure you're looking at the right boy?" You know, but like, it was so amazing just, you know, like learning from him. You know, and not until we find out, and we did, you guys have an opportunity to like dive in. I know we are busy, but you can tell. You can tell when a student is in need, when a student is being challenged. You know, and it takes a second. Dream. You know, Ms. Murakami, she still comes to my shows. She's pushing her little doggy in her carriage. Aww. And she comes to my shows and I go, "Hey, Ms. Murakami right there." Mr. that saw something. They saw challenges. They saw, you know, a lot of bad, but they just focused on the good, and that was enough for me, you know. And so, like, now I feel like, you know, after 26 years of being a professional clown, you know, I feel like this is so much rewarding now to go to schools and talk and help, you know. I'm not no expert. I only can share my experience, so it's been amazing. With that, you know, if you guys have any questions, I'd love to take some questions. Maybe you guys want me to touch on something that I never, maybe you was expecting. I would love to do that right now for you guys. So, anyone have a question? Okay. Whew, one in the back. Same thing that we were like, okay, I feel like I went through every challenge that the high school kids, you know, I was a teen parent. As I was a 1985 Golden Gloves boxing champion. I won free ride when I was 16 years old. And then I had to make hard choices, and my dad wasn't this compassionate guy, like serious tough love. Mind you, my brother was only 1 year old when I made my girlfriend pregnant, so my dad was like, "You think I'm watching your kid? I gotta watch my kid. I gotta go work." And it still resonates, you know, with high school kids flipping burgers. But through boxing, through living in the housing, I understood that you have to work hard. Like, it's something you gotta work hard. And, you know, I, like I said, Ms. Murakami was this lady that taught me, God, she was a guidance teacher. Yeah? You know, she taught us how to apply for jobs in the newspaper. Just simple life skills like that. And after 6 months at Jack in the Box, I was in the newspaper, I was looking, Kapi'olani Medical, $725. Oh, that's more, that's about the same pay my dad has. Because Jack in the Box at that time was like $310. You know, I was getting $110 every 3 weeks, and I think HMSA was like $125. Like, I gotta support my son from Jack in the Box. And luckily, because of boxing, because I got all my credits, I was able to work after lunch. I was able to take half day and go work. So I caught the bus to Kapi'olani Medical, and I demanded an interview. And Ms. Kawamoto was like, "How old are you?" Because they only hire college kids in the UH to go work part-time. So I was like, "I'm 16. Why are you here?" And I told her the truth. And I made a deal with her, and you guys go back and I'll guarantee I'm going to fire them in 2 weeks. You know, it's just probably a lot of dumb kid. And I ended up there for 16 years. Wow. And then at Kapi'olani, I was able to move up. And when I left Kapi'olani to pursue comedy and radio, I was I ran the mayoral department for Kapilani, Palimomi, and Straub. And I was able to buy my home at 21 because I understood credit. I was able to take care of my family. And I tell high school kids that not everybody can mess up. It's your responsibility. You can change from the challenges. I tell high school kids, I tell them the truth. You know, even when my brother passed away from killing himself, you know, it's not your friends who can bury you. At 20, one of the hardest things to do was to go and sit and go to the church to set up your brother's funeral. And my mom and dad was in denial that they were doing drugs. He was doing drugs. Oh, he's good. He's a good boy. You know how local people are. We like to sweep things under the rug. Come on, all this stuff. Sweep up. You know, I was like, no, he's doing drugs. And I had to have that hard talk with him 2 weeks before he passed away, you know, from killing himself. And it was the most hardest thing to do, to go walk, you know, and claim your brother's body. And then you gotta go plan because your mom and dad in denial. Your dad, like, killed the world because, you know, he think somebody did him. Instead of going, you know, maybe, you know, we should have gotten in his life, find out what's going on, you know, and so lots of life experiences. You know, I can only be honest and truthful. You know, and hopefully, you know, it'll resonate and then they can get the help, especially now. But it looks like they get questions. I gotta start all over again.
One specific reason is to
hopefully inspire young kids to step up, you know, and serve the community at stores. And, you know, like, what we doing on the road? I don't know. I'm riding the same road as you. You know, so it's the same thing. You know, my mom and dad live in my house. You know, there's a lot of things we gotta do. Take care of Kupuna. Make sure that the kids get the tools they need. And I just think being the guy that yelled. And if they kick me out after 4 years or I don't win, guess what? I get tons of materials to talk about.
You got plenty
of material. I think you're more confused in real life. You guys, thank you, teachers, for letting me spend some time with you guys this afternoon. You guys have any more questions that you come up with? I guess Facebook. Like me on Instagram. Tweet me on Twitter. I'm trying. Snapchat. Well, thank you. Thank you, Ely, everybody. Thank you, guys. Uber will take me back to the airport.
There are a few of us full-time mental health counselors here at the University of Hawaii. If you don't know where we're located at the second floor of the Student Services Center. We're all the way at the theater end of the building. You can call the 19-7465 number and you'll get Sharon's desk. And Sharon is kind of, she takes care of our scheduling. So the students want to schedule appointments. She has our master schedule and she can see where the times are to students. You can also email Eva Peters that used to work with us. We have students from the Counseling Psychology Program, Andrea and Chilo. And in fact, you know, the three of us, and myself, some of the things that we want to make sure and talk about today is one, being able to recognize the relationship between student mental health and how well-being of our students plays out to them staying here and staying on our campus. Being able to recognize the role that you play and how to respond to students in distress and to making that connection and trying to increase your comfortability and that connection and trying to persuade them. And then master will kind of
anxiety is even higher. So 27, almost 30% of our students said that they experience anxiety. So our students are experiencing a lot of mental health concerns. And only 13 and 14% reported that they've been diagnosed or treated in the last 12 months. So while they're experiencing these concerns, they're not reporting that they're being diagnosed or treated. So there's a gap there. The other thing I thought you might find interesting is what students are reporting on our campus as being traumatic or very difficult to handle for them. I couldn't order this because I just cut and pasted from our report, but academics is the number one. 50% of our students reported that that was the most difficult thing for them to handle. But also high are sleep difficulties, relationship problems, finances. Major changes in behavior or mood, difficulty concentrating, making decisions, being withdrawn, being agitated. In terms of recognizing, are there any questions that you came in with specifically that you want to ask? No? That's why I wanted to have the text app, because we don't like to stick out and ask questions necessarily. It's much easier if you can like quietly put something up on the screen. Yeah.
Actually, when a student is clearly stressed,
yeah.
Not just maybe some more potentially superficial stress,
yes.
Having a crisis, is it more appropriate to call you folks? Counseling center, or to just call
911. If it's then you can walk them up to our office. Yeah. But if there's a crisis,
right? Yeah. And I guess I'm speaking more from the sort of that gray area between distress, clear distress, and crisis. Not quite at the obviously if it's a major crisis.
You can always call us and ask us if you're not sure. If it seems like there's enough time to be able to consult Generational trauma. He said, well, all these things happened to my dad, and then this happened. might say, oh, you have a mental health problem, but it's related back to things that happened to them in life. So that's that shift in perspective. The thing is, potentially traumatizing events don't need to result in trauma if the internal resources and external supports are sufficient. And that's the other thing that Augie was talking about. Compared to maybe his brothers, he had external supports. He had the teacher that... So one of the most common traumatic events is 9/11. But 90% of the people who experience trauma around 9/11 don't have and didn't develop PTSD for that. So post-traumatic growth is called learning. And that's what our students are here to do. College is challenging for them. Augie experienced challenges, right? But he's thriving because he had the supports to do it. So that's what this arrow is about that you have here. The way that we can have that trauma-informed lens to be able to support our students. One is operator has any thoughts about that. But for me, a good example of that one, and I'm going to say this because I don't mean to tell anyone how to teach, but I hear it a lot from students, particularly students who experience social anxiety. They might, whether it's related to their grade or not, there's a lot of pressure to speak up and ask questions or participate in discussions in class. But culturally speaking, it's disrespectful to speak up and speak out, or it kind of calls them out. There could be a couple different reasons why it doesn't feel good for them to participate in a large group in front of the class, or even to ask a question of the professor. But the professor expects them to do that. And I think there are ways around that. I think there are ways to negotiate how students can still participate and still feel respected.
Yeah. So I do a lot of presentations, and it's in the syllabus, so it's outlined in the coming,
yep.
How we do it, and we do a lot of interactive stuff, like we take a half hour and focus on the presentation class that was the last semester, that is being taught, and it looks like we'll have this at the curriculum level, we can do 5 students in the curriculum, and then present to the rest of the class what you have. So we do kind of put the days of present to the occasion, and anybody who's not done the work or done the changes, but they may be feeling uncomfortable with the work. I don't kind of know what to do with that.
Yeah, it doesn't mean that it's not working or doesn't work in your situation, but it could mean that if a student was uncomfortable and they said something, that having cultural humility would mean that you would be able to listen to what they said. And then try to understand it from their perspective. Right? And then be able to maybe talk and negotiate how they could participate in a way that was comfortable and still met the course expectations. And
but if they're not going to tell me that they're uncomfortable at all, then I'm not going to help.
Right. Yeah, that's the tricky part. Yeah, and so maybe they stop showing up in class on the days that they have to do that.
Every
day. They're doing great. So then they do, and that's
so. And maybe it's just all positive feedback because we give them a
also said too, though, that they said, you know, they really appreciated professors who sort of didn't let them, like, didn't accommodate them so much. Because, you know, the professors kind of made them grow up and actually, you know, do the assignments. And you know, because they said, oh, and then this person, this student said, you know, if I could, I would just miss classes. And, you know, and if my teacher was so accommodating, then I would never, like, learn or do well or anything. So, what is, I guess you need a balance then, huh?
Yeah, thank you for that. I think it really is, reminds me of an analogy about the lobster and how lobster grows, that lobster needs to feel the pressure inside. It's the goal of stress management is like to get rid of the stress as you can. The goal of stress management is to get better at managing stress.
And that's part of what Augie said too, right? That he had to take responsibility. He has to take responsibility and he had to grow up and do what he needed to do, and that's part of why he's right. Because his dad didn't just do take his responsibility for him. Yeah, so I think that's an important point. And part of what someone asked me to ask us to address is, well, did that mean that I just, you know, let students not turn in assignments and right? And that's not it at all. So it's not, I don't know where an example is to, yeah, that there's a balance. And it doesn't mean that, but it might mean that for a student who maybe comes in and has severe social anxiety, that it takes them a week to get into that model to be able to do it, for example, right?
Also offer time to make sure that we have the time and can make time feel connected and feel that somebody is listening to them and how powerful that is for them. The other thing I've seen in my own work, and I've seen on how awkward it is whether I'm talking to students who are clients, or even to my kids, or even to my wife, on how important it is to be direct and not to beat around the bush, and to make sure that we are talking about the same thing. That you know, are we talking about suicide? Are we talking about you thinking about hurting yourself, just to get that confirmation in your mind, and to also validate. Also, it's very meaningful to be pointing out and explains the why and the how on why I want to refer to the counselor, and to be able to kind of identify them very specifically. You know, there's these behaviors that, and these things that I'm noticing. That are hard to answer into. This is kind of something that I grew up with. I had the issue to tell me that there's 2 years and 1 month. We're designed to do more listening and talking. But also when we do talk, that we can help validate what it is that we're hearing. It helps kind of confirm what it is that we're assuming or guessing this. That person might be experiencing, I'm sorry, I'm not a but how validating, paraphrasing, and summarizing is that you are present, that you are designed. Be mindful of our writing weakness, we all do it. We can help ourselves. Our thoughts are as problematic and as quick as they can be. And sometimes when people come to us with problems that we kind of put on that picture and then we start offering solutions. And how that can come across as dismissive or even minimizing. And you can kind of tell that you're engaged in the writing reflex or the picture hat conversation when you start entering into a yes but conversation. And you'll kind of throw things out and people will kind of go, yeah, but. So just being mindful of that at times that it doesn't really allow for you to go deeper into the conversation with somebody. This next point is really directly coming out of QPR. Do you see any potential problems with that question? You're not suicidal, are you?
That's an accusatory
question. And also very, you know, kind of you're passing some judgment, you're passing some control. But it also speaks at times to our own uncomfortability to use the word suicide. You know, you're not thinking about suicide, are you? Because I don't know what to do with it after that. And so, you know, just being mindful of the barriers that a student may have about learning, just
information on our website. There's also other opportunities to kind of normalize mental health and help seeking behavior. We have this cool software, which is a biofeedback software, or heart map, where students can learn to kind of breathe and kind of be more attuned to their body, and how even that being kind of just learning how to breathe and having them come to our doors or go to the relaxation, kind of feeling anxious.
Really cool. I love it. The race car game.
Yeah. So is this, are these services open only to UHUO students or are the more community college students who are sometimes part of our population?
Our services are for UHUO students. But if a Hawai'i CC student shows up at any of our outreaches or shows up at our door, we're not going to turn.
But as far as like counseling appointments, Hawai'i CC has a mental health counselor on campus there.
Well, I'm just asking because I have a 32-year-old boy. Can you come to me? Let me get my house to you right now.
Yeah.
And then there's other outside-the-box referrals that you can make, like the text line. If you text a lot, the 741741. Just being with the times and understanding how students are and what their preferences are, how communication is, the state and national plans are trying to be as available as can. There is that text.
What is your team?
So this goes to a national resource.
Oh, okay.
And it's very similar to the National Suicide Hotline.
Yeah, so they'll text Aloha and someone will say, hi, my name is Rebecca. And they'll text back and forth and check in on them and they can have a conversation about what's going on. And if someone is suicidal or experiencing something that's particular to sexual assault, or you know, then they'll refer them on to other resources or else kind of just end up de-escalating and someone feels well enough not to on the next
slide
anymore. Yeah.
Where do you go to see that heart map baby?
Where do you come to play it maybe?
Yeah, or you know, like, is it online? And
We have a map in our lobby area.
Oh, you have to do it there.
And we take it on the road. So we take it on our relaxation station outreaches. And those are our monthly outreaches that we do at campus throughout. We actually kind of move around. And at the relaxation station, there's other relaxation techniques that we explore with the students. So you can go to a mala, you can play with piano, you can create a collage, all with the intent of diversifying their relaxation techniques that if they are feeling overwhelmed, you know, really celebrating self-care and how important self-care is.
Speaking of, this is not for the text line, this is for the suicide
are very fortunate that we have a lot of flexibility in our schedule, where we most of the time can take a walk in the same day. That we even reserve our half of our each day for urgent walk-in, flexibility in our schedule that way. I also want to share with you folks on maybe when you are responding to a student and you try to knock at our doors, they'll be sharing. And lastly, just a reminder that the care team, with the Chancellor of the Affairs Office, that you can always go to their website and fill out a student of concern form. And somebody will go on the check test.
Any other questions? Thank you all so much.